Yes. All right. All right. That's what I wanted to hear. Some good bumper music. Well, good afternoon. It is excellent, excellent, most excellent to see you all live and in person. I was in therapy for many weeks during COVID because of the inability to visit with our members and our strategic partners. And this has been a therapeutic session for me as well. It's been great to see you all. It's great to be here, and it's great to share with you the results of our 2021 state CIO survey. As you heard, we have the always familiar Graham Findley joining me today, principal at Grant Thornton and our partner in crime and colleague with the survey for many years. And he's gonna provide some national perspective. And of course, our two special guests, Jennifer and Katrina, they're gonna provide perspectives from their states and kind of words of wisdom we had from the survey. So let's get started. You heard the approach in terms of the methodology. It's been very similar for many years. And we have 49 states that responded, as you heard Jordan say. We'll talk about the timeline because it's particularly important to understand the timeline related to our term post-COVID. We crafted the questions in April and May. We put the survey in the field in June, and certainly during April and May of 2021, we assumed and believed and prognosticated that we were toward the end of the pandemic, and then Delta arrived. And so the term post-COVID in the survey obviously is out of context today, but I think certainly the data that we have and the responses we have from our state CIOs certainly portray what they felt was going on in the summer, and I think it's very important. Again, you notice that the title of our survey, the theme and the, kind of the thematic treatment that we saw as you looked at all the data was around driving digital acceleration, so that's very, very important. So I do want to remind you all to get your phones out. We will have some poll questions. We're going to ask the audience some perspectives from our survey, and then we're going to show the data that we received from the state CIO, so get that ready. And we're going to start with really looking at the overarching comments around COVID-19, the impact and the transformational activities that took place during COVID, and again with our state CIOs. We had 9 major topics in the survey. We're going to cover just a few of those today, and you can see those highlighted, as I mentioned, starting with the COVID-19 impact and transformation, so that's important. We'll get national perspectives from Graham, and then again, as I mentioned, the state perspectives. So get your phones ready in the Ask the Audience polling question, and let's cue this up. Post-COVID-19, which business processes, practices, or investments will be a big priority for the state CIOs? You can see the responses there. And these responses were also given to the state CIOs in 2020. So we're going to compare and contrast their differences a year later. So if you would go ahead and throw up the question, let's see. Okay, we're moving along. All right, we're going to come back to this in a couple of minutes, in terms of looking at how this compares with the data we saw from our states. All right, let's move on to go back to our topics here. So, a great quote from one of our state CIOs. The survey contained a lot of open-ended comments, and we also did interviews with a number of state CIOs, and we have some excellent comments from them. We thought this quote, it kind of encapsulated their experience around digital acceleration, delivering services during a crisis, and also, again, that enterprise-wide perspective that we have received certainly throughout the survey results as well as in the comments. If you look at the hard copy and the digital copy of the survey, you'll see a number of embedded quotes that I think really embody what the state CIOs were thinking and feeling during those times. So let's look at the first set of data around COVID. And this will compare to, again, what we just saw, and I think you all were right on target in terms of we asked them, because we have a series of forced choice rankings in this survey, we asked our CIOs to rank their top practices and the top 5 changes that they would see, again, using that context post-COVID. And what's interesting, as you all did in your poll, and you nailed it directly, is that digital services enhancement, increased attention to digital services and that experience was far and away number 1, and that moved actually from 2020. So I think I continued to see the challenges of that, and you can then look at the other areas which certainly were illustrated in the 2020 survey as well in the number below there where they ranked in 2020. I think what's interesting is they're the same five are in the priority list, just in different order. And very close at number six was a broader adoption of cloud and SaaS platforms. So SaaS deployment and cloud services adoption were really close at number six. So I guess looking at the national data, I'm going to turn to Graham. Graham, comments and perspectives on that, and then we'll ask our two panelists for their color commentary as well.
Yeah, thanks, Doug. I think one of the main themes that we saw was this sense of, and it's tied to this increased demand from citizens for digital services and adoption, and this sense that speed was really important. You know, speed to market is it's something, a factor that we don't always think about as important in public sector as maybe in some commercial enterprises, but this sense that speed was vital and time to market was really important. We saw this intense acceleration of delivering solutions quickly to meet both the demand for citizen services as well as all of a sudden state employees having to remote remotely and tying into that as a need. And I think one of the other CIOs made this comment that they did about 10 years worth of regular deployments over the course of 8 months. And I think that sort of says it all. So the question I think we're facing now is we've proven that this can work and that states can do things extraordinarily quickly and do them well. The question is whether that speed and sort of sense of pace will continue as we move back into something closer to a normal situation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we'll get into that later, certainly, as we talk a little bit more about digital services enhancement and emerging technology adoption. So you'll see some more data around that this afternoon. Jennifer, how does this top five resonate with your ranking? Is it alignment, or do you have a kind of a different perspective on that?
Yeah, well, it's a little bit funny because I find myself when I go through the survey going, what did I put there? and I read through some of the quotes, and I'm like, that sounded like something I might have said. I don't know. It all resonates with me, basically. Certainly, and I think I've talked about this several times, but resident experience, the digital experience, all of that is definitely top of mind for us. So that one certainly, I know I ranked that number one. I think, you know, what we've all experienced over the last, you know, year and a half or so, really made that very, very evident as the world kind of felt like it shut down in early 2020, that, you know, the residents were relying on government more than ever. And this was as we closed offices and no ability to walk into a brick and mortar location, that online was absolutely critical.
Okay, very good. Katrina, Ohio, what's your perspective on our top five?
So I would agree as well, as Jennifer mentioned, you know, we actually had our Innovate Ohio platform in place. But I think, you know, and agencies were adopting that. That's our digital experience, our identity, our data analytics. And we had agency adoption, but certainly the pandemic hit and it was like, oh, we get it. We need to move. We need to do this. We need to do this now. You know, how can we participate? How can we get on board and make those services available to our customers?
Again, the speed is the operative word that we've heard, and acceleration. So we'll dig into some of that because we have some more data to share with you all. Let's look at automation. We've heard a lot about automation. We heard a lot about, again, accelerated deployment. And we talked about the adoption of emerging technologies. NASIO had done a study in 2019 and saw very low, actually, adoption of things like chatbots, basically virtual agents for online citizen inquiries. That was clearly a necessity during the pandemic. And now you see this again, another fourth choice ranking. Which ones are here to stay? We wanted to say which ones are going to stick. And it's interesting, you can see that chatbots are up there at the top of the list, along with a relatively strong contender with number two, which is in the automated fraud detection and predictive analytics. So we can talk about that in a few moments. But again, a lot of impact on the states with fraudulent activity. So as you look at this, Graham, perspective on that, we know we've talked a lot about RPA as well.
Yeah, I mean, I almost look at this as sort of flip sides of a coin. And I think we're going to see elements of this in some of the other slides later on, that on the one side, you've got an increased demand for online services and digitization and access to information. But the flip side of that is increased risk associated with, you know, cyber attacks and fraud in particular. And so we're seeing in a number of places this concern about increased fraud risk, increasing in consistently with the increase in access to services. They're going together, and there's got to be sort of a combined response.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Katrina, what did you experience in terms of state agencies with any of these technology, but particularly with chatbots and their use? Because they've been, agencies have been kind of resistant to that for many years.
So we have bots in place on our Ohio benefits program, and I think, and we've done a good job of talking to our agencies about how those, how we use that technology, and I think we're going to see more adoption there. We actually had a multi-agency group looking at RPAs. So there's a lot of interest from the agencies in RPA.
On the RPA side, you got baby bots. You've all heard about baby bots, yeah. So.
Yeah, Chris is here, she can talk about baby bots.
Yeah, tell them about baby bots.
Baby bots is the enrollment for newborns on our Ohio benefits program. Mm,
yeah, so it's RPA driven, a lot of script in there. Right. Jennifer, your experience in Illinois in terms of some of these technologies, and are they gonna stay around?
Yeah, so all of these, I think we've implemented, and you know, I think the whole theme of this accelerated is a good term, because I've said previously, I think that, you know, all of these things were sort of on our plan, but we moved them up really quickly, just seeing the need, and they've certainly served as the force multiplier for the agencies that were just overwhelmed with demand. You know, one thing, I think these are here to stay to some degree, but I worry, the agencies sometimes have a short memory, and as they start to get pressed with budget difficulties and, you know, that demand starts to subside, sometimes they're like, oh no, this costs a lot of money and our federal money's going away, we might want, you know, and so we're working already to make sure they recognize the value of what they've put in place here and that this is something that's needed long term.
Mm-hmm. Did you see, in terms of the response from the citizens, that same resistance? We've heard some other states that there was high level of adoption, things like chatbots, but like you said, do you have citizen complaints that they need to speak to a real state employee and not a bot?
No, I really have not heard that. I think the public generally, I know I think about it for myself, and maybe it depends on personal preference. Most of the time, you know, I would prefer to just text,
get it
or
done,
not have to talk to someone. So we didn't hear that. There's some that just will always, they're going to call no matter what, but didn't really hear any significant complaints.
Very good. So let's dig in a little bit. As you heard, the major theme of the survey and the studies, we looked at all the data, and Graham and I looked at all the comments, was really around that enhancement of digital services to a great degree. And that was, again, a thread that you could look through all the chapters, that was critical, that states were exposed to a degree, and the fragility of all that was exposed, and they needed to respond very quickly. So we've got some data to look in around motivation, and then what they did. So we've talked about emerging technology, so let's get your phones out and let's answer a quick poll question about what emerging IT area will be the most impactful in the next 3 to 5 years. We have asked this question, I think, 6 or 7 straight years in the survey. We saw some interesting results for 2021. So take your chance to vote in and weigh in on this.
Yeah, here come the rooster. Yeah. You know we ain't gonna die.
Interesting. So we will compare and contrast. We'll go back to this. These answers look strikingly familiar to 2020 responses. So we'll see how they came out in 2021. So let's move on here and talk about digital services and the drivers behind that. Again, we've heard about the need for better service experience. The consumers, as citizens, as consumers in the marketplace, expect kind of a seamless, secure, trusted transaction. They're used to those capabilities, and again, many states have yet to deliver that kind of experience for citizens, but we see that's been a driving factor. A lot of states use that motivation to be able to do this during the pandemic, and the demand, the traditional brick and mortar organizations were not available, they couldn't work, so states had to move very quickly, and their state CIOs had to be, again, very innovative and very flexible and adaptable. Not surprising, I guess, is that that better service, citizen service experience, 3/4 of the state said that was the biggest driver to that. So, Graham, when you look at that and the other topics, any surprise there that came up in number one?
Well, no surprise, but it does raise the question, I think, that's been brought up, you know, a moment ago about now that brick and mortar access to services is starting to open up again, the demand is there, has been there. Will it continue? And will that continue the impetus for increased adoption of digital services once we start to exit out of the pandemic? And that's still an open question.
Correct. Yeah, so if you look at other data in the survey, 94% of our state CIO respondents, 94% said that digital services expanded and increased. In some cases, more than half said they increased dramatically during the pandemic. Jennifer, your experience, not surprising that increased dramatically during the pandemic.
Yeah, no, not at all. Yeah. And we had such a large gap there to fill, so it had nowhere to go but up. So yeah, not a surprise. And and I would hope too that the, you know, as we talk about how will this continue long term, and the storefronts are kind of opening back up, the offices are opening back up, I think as we get better at digital experience, I hope, you know, it would shift back to, you know, oh, it's super easy to go online, and so I don't need to go into the office anymore.
Yeah. Do you have a specific, maybe a specific example from the state agencies you can point to where you saw that kind of dramatic shift?
Yeah, our Department of Employment Security, which handles, you know, UI insurance, obviously completely overwhelmed, and a lot of their, you know, customers, clientele were used to showing up in an office or calling in maybe, and so with the offices closed and their phones were overwhelmed, and you know, I mean, all kinds of activity. So they were the first place we went with, you know, our really the virtual agents and the chatbots was to that agency to a lot of success.
Yeah, same thing, Katrina, experience from any examples in Ohio.
Yeah, so in Ohio, during the pandemic, we rolled out new functionality, new digital experience for our BMV services. So part of that, we did find that for whatever reason, a lot of people like to physically go to the BMV, whereas you could actually do some of these things online. So
sounds like a pain point to me.
It does, it does. We did implement Get in Line online, so if you do want to go, you can get in line first, you know, at home, and then you get there and you're in line. I did this with my son. He was getting his driver's license, and we went to the front of the line, and people looked like they wanted to kill us. But I was like, no, it's a thing. Look right here on your phone. You could do this, too.
Like FastPass.
It was. It was total FastPass. Yeah. So certainly with BMV services and, I had another one in mind. I just forgot what it was.
Shoot. It's okay.
But I'll think of it.
So again, no surprise there. Let's talk about some of the digital services that were instituted during the pandemic. Again, back to the question, so post-pandemic, what's going to stick? And again, I think we've already heard about remote work, so I'm going to ask our CIOs about that, and we'll talk about some of the other answers. But you can see a very close cohort there for the top three. Again, more digital services, more web-enabled, and we'll talk a little bit about fraud prediction, fraud analytics, but again, that's going to be an area that states are going to have to invest in substantially. So I guess I'll go back to Katrina in terms of remote work. So where are you today in the state of Ohio, and what do you, I guess, predict? I'll say, what do you forecast in terms of the continuation of remote work for the executive branch, at least?
So we did start a phased-in return in July. Mm-hmm. Kind of based on facilities and that type of thing, just wanted to keep those occupancy rates kind of lower. DAS, Department of Administrative Services, which is my agency, starts back this week. But we're seeing most in a hybrid approach, you know, 2 days on site, you know, 3 days remote. So that seems to be the general direction of most state agencies. Very small pockets are going 100% remote, some service desks and things like that. But we're seeing everybody kind of come back and, you know, continue to leverage those tools that they hadn't really leveraged before, from Teams and OneDrive. Okay. And all of that.
Good. Same question, Jennifer. What's your what's in terms of the scope of the remote work activities, and you think that's going to be a standing policy?
Yeah, it's very similar to what Katrina just described for us as well. Every agency is doing something a little bit different, what works for them. Mm-hmm. So some of them have had some of their workforce back already, but most agencies are kind of working through what does the longer term policy look like for a hybrid option. So it's interesting, but I think the great thing is that we've been able to prove that it's worked. The technology is certainly there. The other pieces that tend to worry people, I try to remind them, you know, that's a management issue. That's not necessarily the technology issue to solve. So I think it's been very successful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Graham, looking at this data, you and I talked, I think I was surprised to see the fraud be so high, be at that, you know, 82%, even though it was a significant business problem. A lot of the CIOs were not dealing directly with those agencies like UI and others that had that significant fraud. They were kind of, arm's length away, and probably rightfully so. They wanted to stay out of the line of fire with all of the challenges. So thoughts on these responses?
Well, I think it's just another signal that the technology platforms of the state are getting so deeply involved with the day-to-day interactions with citizens and employees that they can't really be extricated. And the more you get this increased use, and we all saw sort of the explosion of bad actors during COVID, and that's really heightened people's expectations of, you know, what's really at risk. And so people are paying, you know, they've always been paying attention to it, but it's come very much to the top, you know, in front of people's opinions.
Yeah, and I think if you look at this in terms of the impact on the states and what you're gonna see in the future from federal funding, the estimates out of the pandemic unemployment assistance was about $800 billion to the states. The own inspector general in Department of Labor said that about 10% of that they expect to be fraudulent payments. So that's $80 billion. Most think that is incredibly low estimate. So congressional folks have told us it could be $200 billion. So across the country. So $200 billion is some serious money when you start counting it. So, excuse me, let's look at the emerging technology discussion. So if you can go back to the poll results in your brain here, we had about 47-48% said that artificial intelligence was gonna be the most impactful in the next 3 to 5 years. Well, interesting enough, what jumped up this year was low code, no code. So it's part of our Energizer plan. We want to highlight QuickBase for low code, no code. So yeah, so again, a very high level of adoption that was pretty nascent in agencies 3 or 4 years ago. We weren't hearing too much about it, but dramatically elevated again, need for speed. Graham, comments on our changes here in our in emerging technology topics.
Yeah, I mean, if you'd asked me that same question before we put the survey online, I probably would have answered it the same way that the audience did. I think the fact that remote work came up as to number 6, so there's obvious reasons for that. The low code, no code was a bit of a surprise until we started thinking about it, and then it really wasn't a surprise at all. And then we realized that it's almost a technology whose time was perfect for the moment because of the need for speed and the ability to break down maybe bigger problems into smaller bite-sized pieces and field them, you know, rapidly, and it's a technology class that's, you know, ideal for that. And so now we're saying, we'll talk about this a little bit more later in the presentation, but we're starting to see, I think, a much more maybe disciplined approach to thinking about these platform-based solutions and how they're fielded, but it's certainly, you know, I think probably all of us in the room have just seen the explosion of use.
And we had governors that said, I need a vaccine registration system in a week, I need a vaccine scheduling system the week after that, and so, you know, unmanaged expectations from elected officials, and they had to move. So, you know, putting those together was pretty interesting. Katrina, experience, obviously, a low-code, no-code, but particularly anything else that you want to highlight that you think will be more impactful in the next 3 to 5 years from your state?
Maybe just to build on what you just said about, you know, the governor saying, I need this in a week, and IT delivered, and now the expectation is, well, IT can continue to deliver at that speed. So, you know, no pressure.
No pressure, no unmanaged pressure. Expectations
yeah,
for the
exactly.
future. Yeah, we've
exactly.
heard that from kind of pandemic.
Yeah.
Jennifer, your thoughts on any of the emerging technology?
Yeah, I would say, you know, for us too, certainly, you know, low code, those type of solutions, you know, we're looking at that heavily and have adopted a little bit there already. And but also I think, you know, the artificial intelligence and RPA is key for so many things, not just, you know, on the business side and the business processes, but for us in IT operations to utilize those for ourselves. And we've adopted quite a bit of that, more than we've ever had. So, and are still looking to do more. And I think that's highly beneficial when you've got, struggling with, the workforce and the talent and bringing in enough staff and all of the demands that we continue to see, taking out some of those, you know, less, I won't say unimportant, but you know, those things that can be filled with using RPA instead to do some of the very manual tasks that are repetitive, will be a huge, huge time saver for us, and focus on other things for better delivery to the agencies.
So good point. So quick question for both of you. So our every year, our top CIO priority is cybersecurity and risk management, risk reduction. So tying that together with this, we see the need for machine learning in the cyberspace or log analysis of a lot of things. Anything going on in Illinois that you can talk about?
Of course, we never want to talk too much about it, but we're adopting lots of new things. And I'll just say, investing in new technologies for us, as well as using some of those analytics tools, those ability to supplement, you know, what we have, certainly a pretty large team in our SOC, but you know, having those tools that can sort of pull out the anomalies for us and alert us is huge. And even just across the board for our agency, we didn't always have a lot of, which is crazy for an agency of our size, but we didn't even have a ton of tools in place for monitoring systems generally. So we've adopted a lot of that in the last year and a half, 2 years as well.
Yeah, Katrina, what about you in terms of analytics on cyber?
So I think I would, you know, cyber certainly at the top of mind, and just maybe kind of going back to what you mentioned on fraud, I think on the previous slide, some of the conversations and struggles I think we had in talking to some of the business side was, you know, you want secure, you don't want fraud, but you also don't want to limit anyone from applying for benefits and things like that. And there was kind of a conflict in that and trying to get people to understand.
A little tension there.
Yes, exactly. The choices that we're going to have to make here. Yes.
Exactly. Yeah. So let's switch gears and talk about one of the other major topics, and certainly something that has received a tremendous amount of attention nationally. It's one area I can tell you of technology that governors talk about all the time because they can kind of grasp the concept of connectivity and broadband in rural areas and the homework gap and the challenges with digital equity. And so this is one topic that every governor is going to really address. We've seen states that are literally spending and investing billions of dollars of their own money, and we already have billions of dollars of federal funding available for broadband expansion and adoption. And there's a lot of other issues that need to be addressed. So I'm going to put up a poll question here in a moment. We're going to ask the audience their perspective on what some of those challenges are in terms of the roadblocks to broadband deployment in the state. So is it accurate data? Is it coordinating the funding approaches across the board? Is it affordability? Is it topography? So again, take a few seconds to what you think is the number one roadblock to deployment of broadband in the states. Got the good soundtrack going here. That's good. All right, it looks like 42%, 41% coordinating the funding approach. So we will come back to this in a moment. We'll see what our state CIO said in terms of their responses. Interesting enough, it's topography, number one. So we asked them to choose their top three. And again, as you can see from the data, very, very consistent, but also very split in terms of the funding approach, the topography, affordability, and right in there tied with that was accurate mapping. We've heard a lot about the challenges of census block data from the FCC, the collection of data from the carriers, the reporting of data. A number of states have innovative programs to dig down and get that data. We've seen that's a consistent problem across the states. It's one of NASIO's federal advocacy priorities is actually for broadband is to promote more accurate data program from the FCC, and we've seen that actually now moving along. Graham, we've talked a lot about broadband during the pandemic, so thoughts on the kind of the national view of what we've seen from the survey data?
I mean, just a couple of things. This was one of the few areas where we did see in some cases the CIO's actual roles change over the course of the pandemic. There weren't many, but broadband is one area where in some states the CIOs took on quite significant responsibilities that they didn't have before. I was actually keying on the data and mapping piece of it myself because, you know, we always talk about money and how to get money and whether there's enough money. There's not a lot you can do about the topography of your state. You know, that's something of a fixed item, but you can do something about the data on mapping. And so it's an area that there's, you know, an actual ability to influence the outcome. And so I'm interested to see sort of what happens with this in terms of the next year, given so much emphasis on broadband deployment now.
Yeah. And Karina, you have a pretty robust broadband program, and the state has for many, many years. You did broadband mapping, as I can recall, back in the 90s, and working with Ohio and the data center. Thoughts on these responses? You have a topography issue as well.
We do. Southeast Ohio. Yeah. So we're working very closely with our Lieutenant Governor's office. This is something top of mind for this administration, as well as the Broadband Ohio office, which is out of our Department of Development. Just last week or the week before, I think, we had an announcement in Washington County, working with Southeast Ohio Broadband Coalition, leveraging our multi-agency radio communications towers. So that's our first responder system. And we have towers throughout the state. So leveraging that infrastructure to provide, you know, the Southeast Ohio Broadband Coalition on there, and they can extend their broadband to that area of the state. So we're gonna extend that to two other counties, Jackson and Scioto as well. So we're pretty excited about that, you know, moving that needle. I mean, I think broadband's been on the list too long. let's keep it moving. So I'm hoping that we can move the needle here.
Let me ask you a follow-up on that in terms of, so we have FCC subsidies. If we had fiber connectivity to every single home in the state, you still have an affordability issue.
Exactly.
Right?
I mean,
so
that's...
What, is the state weighing in on that with
that's
anything?
That's something that we're working with. The Broadband Ohio office is conscious of. You know, we have some programs looking for devices. So, you know, for rural, so it's not just a rural issue, right? It's an urban issue. They had a program in East Cleveland with PCs for the people. So getting people connectivity, getting them devices, and then connectivity that's affordable so they can maintain that.
Yeah, so Jennifer, you've got obviously rural areas, but you also have incredibly concentrated urban metropolitan areas, and they both have a digital divide in terms of broadband. Mm-hmm. Thoughts on what kind of you focused on in terms of these top issues when in terms of roadblocks to broadband?
Yeah, so similarly, our governor actually championed and implemented a broadband funding in 2019. It passed that session, $400 million from capital funding to focus on this issue. We don't manage it, our Commerce Department manages those grants, but they're focusing on these as, you know, doing them as public-private partnerships. They're eligible to apply, or nonprofits or municipalities, and and some of the same things, looking at affordability and doing mapping as part of this too for our state. And I wouldn't say we have topography issues, we're pretty flat. So easy on that front. But for us, our agency manages the Illinois Century Network, which is the state's fiber backbone that really links anchor institutions throughout the state, so state government and universities. And and one of the things that we also got with that $400 million was another $20 million to sort of refresh components of that, as well as fund K-12 ability. So we're completely bringing on every K-12 public school district in the state completely free. So they've got unlimited broadband, unlimited speeds, and additionally, we've moved them behind next-gen firewalls, and mm-hmm. So they've got additional security as well. And I just saw today something from President Biden about doing an assessment on K-12 and the attacks that they're facing. And so I feel like, hey, we're ahead of the game on this, I think. So, yeah.
Follow-up question. You mentioned Commerce Department. So 20 years ago, the broadband offices were all pretty much under the CIO or under the Department of IT. right now it's about a quarter of those. We've seen a dramatic shift to commerce, local government, economic development. Mm-hmm. So Broadband Office is not under your purview, mm-hmm. but how are you involved? Are you on the task force, commission, council?
Yeah, our network folks and our CTO have been heavily involved. You know, their background and expertise just from running the ICN, and they've brought a lot of that and been heavily involved in how they prioritize the funding and the grants.
Yeah, mm-hmm. same thing for you, Katrina.
Yeah, ours is in Department of Development, and I think we got $250 million in the last biennial budget for a grant program, but that's being handled yeah. through Broadband Ohio and Development. But yeah, I'm engaged. I meet weekly with the executive director.
Right. So that's, again, you know, kind of connecting those dots, critical to the enhancement of digital services. If the states want to roll out, you know, basically high quality, rich media types of platforms to deliver services, citizens obviously have to have more than their current speed at that, you know, for that and for distance learning and other applications for telehealth. So we're going to see that. The current infrastructure bill contains $65 billion in additional money, $65 billion. Because infrastructure in that bill, at least the digital infrastructure, is included. Now, whether that gets passed or that current language in it remains to be seen, but that's another pretty large number for broadband. So let's, a couple more topics before we end today. So again, let's look at one which I think has become, it's again, directly tied to digital citizen services, as well as the enhancement of security within state government, but also one that for the first time in 2021 appeared on the top 10 list for state CIOs, and that's identity and access management. I've always called this the big part of the knowing doing gap in terms of state government. Identity and access management has been discussed for many, many years, and has just recently begun to see some deployment in state. So we wanna kind of ask some questions of our panelists about this. So we have two dimensions of this. One is the external facing and the citizen services aspects of some type of digital identity or digital identity and access management initiative. And then the internal side, what are states been doing with IAM for agencies within the executive branch of government? So I'll go kick it back to Graham here for his commentary on identity and access management.
Yeah, we did have CIOs comment to us that they overwhelmingly felt that the pandemic had increased the demand for these digital identity services. And again, it's that flip side, the two sides of a coin, increased access, making it easier for people to access services at the same time trying to manage risk associated with that. But it's an area we've seen, I would say, a consistent, relatively low level of focus. I actually went back and looked, I think the last time in the survey we asked a specific question about identity and access management was all the way back in 2013. And the numbers don't look very different in 2013 than what they do today. A lot of partially implemented. And so I'm interested to see over the next year or so, with this really increased focus on it, do we see those numbers move?
Yeah, and I think that we're certainly talked a lot in our commentary about, again, the immaturity of the states years ago, and I think we're going to hopefully see some acceleration of this because of the pandemic demand. Ohio has a very innovative digital identity program for citizens. Mm-hmm. I'm going to talk about your thoughts on both of these, sure. Katrina, and where that, what are the elements of your external one? Because you're one of the states that has, is it fully implemented yet?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I thought. So they're one of the states. So that 6% is essentially, if you think about it, in the nominal, it's three states. So that only reported that they had fully implemented a citizen digital identity program. So thoughts on that?
Yeah, so OHID, it's part of our Innovate Ohio platform. We rolled it out initially to workforce. So there's workforce ID, citizen ID as well. And we work with agencies to onboard their applications. We're working right now with our Department of Public Safety to onboard BMV. That will add, I think, 4 million to the platform, as well as with our Job and Family Services. To add Ohio Means Jobs and Ohio Job Insurance, so a lot of overlap in those groups, but significantly increased. I think we have 1 million citizens on right now, so we're just looking to keeping that moving.
So how do citizens obtain a digital identity from the state in terms of your level of assurance? Is it a rigorous process? There are multiple levels that they can... How does that work?
So it's more multi-level. So dependent, you can have a base ID, right? But then depending on the application that you may be trying to access, okay. You may have a more rigorous, you know, process. ensuring your identity.
Okay, very good. Jennifer, your thoughts on digital identity? What's your programs and where are you in the implementation stage?
I'd say we're still pretty much at the beginning of it. We had started to kick this off internally for employees around, you know, several applications. You know, when we got into COVID and started looking at this and the challenges, we thought, you know, maybe again, there's that word accelerate this program and deal with both, you know, the resident side, that public facing side, but also kind of business side. And I say that in terms of, you know, when we implemented a contact tracing solution, and that was really with all of our local health departments. So looking at them as sort of business users and using that interface for them. And then we've really just in the last month, 2 months, kicked off a couple of the public facing applications, both our Vax Verify solution and then our unemployment insurance system. Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about a related topic, which I think many states see as the future of being able to deliver digital credentials across the enterprise, which is mobile driver's license. So we have five states now that have already implemented digital mobile driver's license, and we see about 10 more that are moving along. Where's that in your path?
Yeah, we actually don't manage
Secretary
of State does that, although I know they've talked about they're looking at it, so I think that's quite possible still to come for them. I think they're interested and may have already embarked a little bit down that path.
Yeah. Ohio?
That would require a law change for us. We do have, we're going to be able to do online renewals starting in July of next year, so that's something that we're working with the BMB on right now. But we don't have the digital license at this point.
Yeah, so the TSA has announced in 2022 that there's 11 states that they are gonna accept the digital mobile driver's license on your phone to board a plane. So that'll be an interesting transition. So get ready for that. The interoperability questions are pretty, I don't wanna get pulled over for speeding in Ohio and show my digital driver's license and say it's not authentic. So we'll have to see about that. So again, identity and access management, put that at the top of your list, I think, in terms of potential for growth. And we know we have a number of corporate members here that specialize in that, but I think we're going to see dramatically more attention, again, prompted by the demands during the pandemic, the realization that the states really needed to roll that out for their citizens to create that kind of seamless experience, and certainly follow what Ohio's doing, because they are a national leader right now in that space for the citizen piece. One of the critical areas around this, and I think this is problematic, unfortunately, because of, and this is one of the areas that has stymied growth in IAM, is the fact that state CIOs are taking this out of their hide because they're using it as a service, as a chargeback model, because of, again, that's the predominant model in the states is chargeback for services to agencies, and it's difficult to carve out those dollars. So states are thinking about this as identity as a service from the CIO perspective they can deliver. So I'm going to turn it over to Graham for thoughts. We had a lot of discussion about these challenges.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I would say around this, there's a little bit of a reflection of some of the similar conversations we've had about cybersecurity over the years, where a lot of CIO organizations were having to fund cybersecurity in a similar manner. It's to what extent you recognize this is a common good, you know, that needs to be funded more generally, and it's not down to particular usage at an agency level, and you know that opinion is different state by state.
Yeah. So. Your program, how is that funded out of Innovate Ohio?
We used capital funds for build, but our operating funds are charged back.
Okay, sustainable though, because mm-hmm. you got that capital
right.
to start up, and
right.
so you kind of build that in. Mm-hmm. Jennifer?
Yeah, we pretty much charge everything back.
Charge everything back.
For the
back,
most part, you know, some things we've brought up, we've been able to fund specifically out of, you know, related to COVID, and but it's not always, you know, for us, sometimes it's, We start on the path to do everything, figure out where we're getting the money from later, has sort of been the model for us over the last year and a half. And it's fine, and then we get, here's your money. and then we don't have to charge, but most everything we're charging back.
Yeah, and I think we've seen the ARPA funding be able to stimulate some of this, but again, that federal funding stream is, as I always say, the federal government is not a reliable a business partner long term. They can help you start up, but again, you at some point the state's going to have to pick up the tab. It's not sustainable, so we'll see how that that goes. And again, this applies, I think, from the security side for things like MFA. We have a lot of states that employed MFA for all of those employees and contracts within a state, and that's clearly necessary. But that's going to have to be something that is sustained, has sustained funding, because it's critical to maintain that. So let's jump into our last topic, not surprisingly, legacy modernization. Again, an area that we saw a lot of challenges during the pandemic in terms of scalability and flexibility. We have a lot of technical debt in the state, a lot of aging platforms, a lot of platforms that maybe weren't that old but didn't meet the accelerated and expansive business needs of citizens. And so there was a lot of effort looking at this. So we've got a poll question, and then we're going to spend our last few minutes talking about this in a little more depth. So get your phones out and look at this. This is for you to kind of prognosticate in terms of the agency and the major lines of business. We asked our CIOs, what's the where do they see their most investment going in the next 2 years in terms of these topics? You know, the human services area, the entitlement programs, and obviously benefits, licensing and permitting. We talked about UI, so we have labor and employment in there, and also education. So quickly give your responses to this poll. Very good. We'll come back to this data, but let's look at, again, some of the policy and motivation stuff. Looks like we're close to 60% on the human services side. That is the bulk of the compute platforms in state government, so it's not surprising. So we're looking at this in terms of, again, as the strategy changed, and we heard a lot about the title of the report, so I'll go to Grant for some commentary on, again, the fact that we've had a significant amount of funding available both at the state level and the federal level for modernization.
Yeah, I mean, not really much of a surprise. I think we would have been surprised if the numbers were anything different from what they were.
That's right.
This is more of a confirmation of what we expected, just mm-hmm. that, you know, the last 18 months really has accelerated deployment of new solutions. And there were, you know, in many cases, there was transformation underway. You know, it's not as if new things were occurring in every case, but it has accelerated it. And if the pandemic did one thing, it stressed a lot of the legacy platforms, almost to destruction in some cases, and it really highlighted the needs for continued investment.
Yeah, I think across the country, 404 was a common code that everybody saw in their web browser when they tried to apply for unemployment. Jennifer, your thoughts on this? It obviously accelerated the deployment. Does anything surprise you from the answers from your colleagues?
No, I mean, all of this resonates for us, and we've always had, you know, modernization on the list, and it's a huge beast to tackle. We have so many different legacy systems that have been built over the years, and seems like nothing ever gets decommissioned. We just build more. So we were focused on that already, and yeah, we certainly saw the massive stress on some of these systems, our websites as well. At one point really early on, we had to even bring down those server farms and replatform on another one because we couldn't even they were crashing from all of the services that were, you know, all the individuals trying to apply for services. And had to dig into what was going on with a lot of these, particularly the unemployment insurance system, really work to tune those and get them to respond and be able to handle what we were seeing.
So a little over a third of your colleagues indicated that they're going to have, there's greater CIO oversight and control because of that and these legacy modernization. Did you experience that? Do you see that going forward, that you're going to have a little bit more authority and oversight in that?
I think it was, it definitely raised the profile of what probably every CIO, every state has been talking about for years, which is, you know, we can't continue to run these legacy systems. They're unsupported. That's sort of in one ear and out the other sometimes for the business side. You know, they don't want to necessarily spend money on that. But this brought, I think, right to the forefront exactly why we've been talking about those things and how it does impact their business, what they need to do, how they do their job. So I do hope long term that this is something now that they retain. And you know, certainly we couldn't deal with everything. We sort of made things work in the heat of the moment, but long term we're looking at now targeting, okay, now we've talked about it. You see, like, they all kind of say, like, yeah, how do we replace this now?
Katrina, you've got years of experience in looking across the state government in the IT world. Changes in terms of the kind of authority and oversight, is that your perception or is that reality today in terms of the state of Ohio?
You know, I think our legislature became a lot more interested. You know, they were hearing from their constituents, so then there were a lot more questions for IT, and then understanding how IT, works in the state of Ohio. You know, we have a number of agencies, they manage their applications, we manage central services. So kind of having some of those discussions and understanding, you know, they wanted to know, you know, who's responsible, which is a great question.
Yeah, always good, always good.
Right, exactly. Yeah, so exactly. Definitely a different level of interest was raised.
Yeah, well, let's see, yeah. So I think we've seen that fairly universally across is the role of the CIO. If it wasn't changed, it certainly was changed by the pandemic. And so I've always told CIOs, if you're not at the table, you're probably on the menu. And so many of them have, you know, kind of moved up and are at the table and in line of sight of some of these things. So last couple of data points, we've already talked about the adoption of low-code, no-code. So we tied this into modernization, and I thought this was interesting. So 71% indicated, again, 71% of respondents indicated that they had utilized low-code, no-code as part of their legacy modernization strategy. So I guess I'll go to Graham for some final comments on this. You see perhaps some of the approaches that they've used in that area.
Yeah, and obviously, you know, these kind of technologies aren't necessarily an appropriate solution to every type of modernization challenge.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But it is interesting how much more prominence they have now than maybe a year or two ago. What I found most interesting in this, it looks like almost about half of the CIOs are thinking about this at almost a state platform level and thinking about standards across individual agencies and making it more of a state level exercise and not just delegated to the individual agencies to do their own sort of piecemeal projects.
Yes, yeah. So Katrina, low code, no code in your bucket?
Yeah, I mean, I would just agree with what Graham said. That's kind of what we're trying to do as well, you know, more of those standards. We've got some agencies certainly dabbling, I would say, in there with power apps and things like that.
Yeah, just got to reduce the diversity, though.
Right.
Yeah, it's important. Right. Jennifer, your experience during that?
Yeah, same thing. We're certainly starting to get into that world and exploring more and looking at how do we utilize it. But same thing, we're trying to, you know, reduce the footprint of all of these different things and, you know, really narrow down the stack that we're trying to support and for multiple reasons and standardize on platforms that can be utilized across the board and as many things as possible so we have less to manage and
yeah so some good opportunities out there. So final thoughts for today around kind of major business lines, and if you recall the poll question, not surprisingly, very similar to this data is that most of you, almost half of you said it was going to be human services and the kind of public welfare, the public entitlement programs and the benefit programs, and that's where most of the money has traditionally gone in state government on the modernization front, and it continues to go that way. Labor and employment, if you look at the data from 2020, about 20 states still had not modernized their UI claims processing platform. And not only did they see that impact, but almost every state saw a dramatic impact. But certainly those which were still running on old legacy platforms experienced significant challenges. And again, those were 20 states just as little as 2 years ago. So I think we're going to see that. And again, not surprisingly, the other pieces, we're going to see some money. So there's your kind of opportunity map for many of the folks in this room that are focused on that. So Graham, I guess final thoughts of this and then of the survey for today as we close out.
Just that, you know, I think consistent with the whole theme of today's, you know, session, with maybe one exception on that list, all the top areas of business lines are ones that have direct interaction with the citizens. Mm-hmm. And that's, I think, the theme.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Where are you going to put your money? There's billions on the table, Katrina. Where's it going?
Billions on the table. Yeah. Well, I would say I think ours fall in 1, 2, and 3 as well. And that's where we've seen a lot of it. And you know, prior to the pandemic, we were right there ready to modernize systems such as UI, such as our disease reporting system, and all those things kind of got, you know, waylaid a little bit. So coming back around to those.
Okay. Jennifer, thoughts on the modernization journey here?
Yeah, same. We're probably in every one of those buckets that we need to work on. So for sure, yeah, it's we will be working on all of those for quite some time.
Okay, well, we've just covered less than half of the topics in the survey. We have cloud in there and cyber, others that you can dig into. There are hard copies of the survey available for you outside the door of the ballroom that you can take with you. You'll see them out there. Post-pandemic bold black. We had a lot of conversation about our graphic and creative treatment here. And in addition, shoot the QR code up on the screen and you can go to a great interactive site. In addition, the digital versions are available on the NASIO website in Grant Thornton, and you can download those today if you want light reading. But again, please join me in thanking our great panel today to discuss our 2021 survey.